हेलो सर, गुड मॉर्निंग।
मैडम, गुड मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर, ज्वाइन करना है थी
ना आसी ना थी।
सान को सीधा कथा ही दिले।
हाँ, कल रात्रि कथा है।
आपण कोटी ऑफिस रे अछन?
हेलो।
आपण कोटी ऑफिस रे अछन कि
ना, मो घरे अछि।
आमो एठी तो काली राती रो पावर कट हो जाइछे,
हाँ,
किछि माने चार्ज भी फोन रे नाही ना, मोबाइल रे बहुत कम चार्ज अछि, तो मु बाय फोन कनेक्ट हो जाइछे।
हाँ ठीक अच्छे,
आई
कुछ
होप
असुविधा
क्लास करबा जाय मोर चार्ज थीबो।
नहीं। हाँ, पिला नो मैसेज दे तो मैडम।
हां, पिला मान को मैसेज दैछि, मु पर्सनली इन्फॉर्म करछि, ग्रुप रे भी मैसेज करथली।
और टिके गोड़ दिया का कांटेक्ट कर दियो तू, पिला जोन के करना, जोने जोने लर्नर अच्छा।
हाँ, हेलो शीतल मैम, आपण को देह केमती अछि?
हेलो, आई एम फाइन थैंक यू। आपण केम जानले?
से ग्रुप रे जणे कहुतले।
ओके
मैडम, सर जॉइन करनी।
हेलो सर, सर गुड मॉर्निंग। सर माइक ता म्यूट अछि बोधे। स्पीकर स्पीकर बटन को क्लिक करूं?
बर्तमान सुविधा?
यस यस सर।
अच्छा ओके।
सर आई थिंक वी शुड वेट फॉर 2 मिनट्स।
वी विल वेट फॉर 2 मिनट्स। मो ऑफ कोर्स विजेल है?
हां सर।
नथी बथा उ चलियो
सर। नमस्कार।
नमस्कार
सर, कैन यू रिकॉग्नाइज मी?
श्योर श्योर, यू विजिटेड, आई मेट यू।
यस सर, एट मोस्ट प्रोबेबली भुवनेश्वर सर। दिस इज हेमंत हियर सर, वन ऑफ योर स्टूडेंट।
या
हाउ आर यू सर?
फाइन, मैनेजिंग लाइक दैट।
Okay, so just I got the information that you are going to take a class today, so I thought that I should take this opportunity to learn.
Yeah, okay, we all are learners.
Yes sir.
I am very poor in technology, so yes, because sir. I have been socialized as a chalk and the talk teacher. Blackboard, we are acquainted with talk and chalk. Chalk and talk.
And so many research has shown that is the best pedagogy to teach the students. The information has not still able to reach up to that level, which can contribute to a higher education level. So still,
if I do I content is not there, the impression is not enormous.
I totally do agree with you, sir.
Not a question of speaking, it's a question of body language, it's a question of viewing each other. A lot
sir,
more things are happening.
Definitely sir, I do agree with you totally sir.
Right. So long back I read one book, Pedagogy of the Oppressed.
So
Pedagogy of the Oppressed. How Paulo Freire has written that.
Okay.
And he has mentioned, like bank, you know, there is a banking concept of education.
Mm-hmm.
You deposit some money and whenever you require, you withdraw, isn't it? So you know what is left. Like that, you teach the students, and if you know how much the students have learned, you examine them.
Exactly, sir.
This is the banking concept of education.
Yes, sir. Actually, sir, there are two types of system is currently going on in India.
Uh-huh.
This digital transformation of education.
Yeah.
Whereas second side of the coin is that in the rural part and in the tribal parts, these things has not reached till yet. And even the teachers are not going to attend the primary schools. These are my observations since last 20 years field work in
fact
research.
Yeah,
so this dimension has brought an disequilibrium between the education system, and which needs to be strengthened somehow. So digitalization has only beneficial to some extent only to for the urban areas.
I thank COVID-19 for making me aware of this webinar.
It's so nice of you sir. Everybody has are learning, has become an anthropologist. We every day and every hour learning.
It is a forced learning.
Yes. Yeah. Hello Keith and all.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. We will discuss.
Yeah, you are welcome.
We will discuss after the class. And now I like to welcome to everyone. I am Sushri Sangeeta Saraf, academic consultant, tribal studies, Tribal State Open University. And I welcome to you all to the another class of Diploma in Tribal Studies. Today we will discuss on the tribal policies and legislations in India, where we will know deeply the 5th 5-year plan, the Forest Rights Act, Pesa Panchayat, etc. It will deliver by Professor Premanand Panda, the Vice President of Vasundhara, the national level NGOs, and the former Director of SCST RTI. He has taken already our two classes, so it's not a brief introduction, but I like to tell you one thing about him. He is associated with the principal investigator in a few major research project and collaborated in one global project of genome studies. So many scholar has awarded under his supervision, and he is a very dynamic academician. So now I like to request our resource person to start the class. Sir, please.
Thank you, Susri. Thank you very much. Now let me take the opportunity to welcome my virtual students. Now, before I start to discuss on the tribal policy, I would wish to speak something as what would the procedure of scheduling a new community as scheduled tribes. So that is also a part of this course, right? Now, let me start speaking from the earliest one, when the concept of tribe has come and how the policy was guided by those background concepts. Way back in 1891, tribes were identified as tribal forms on the basis of religion, right? So it is stated Britishers wanted to put them as a category of people and said those who are using their own worldview in terms of tribal religion, and they perceive everything a part of nature, they should be treated as tribes. In 1901 and also in 1911, the tribal people have been identified as a tribal animistic. Yes, please. Hello, interruption is there? Is there any problem?
No, sir. No.
Okay, fine.
Vidatta, sir, I have to mute for you.
In 1921, these tribals have been identified as, forest tribes. In 1931, a new term has come, which is referred to as a primitive tribe. In 41 and 51, taking these background materials, Government of India after independence treated them as scheduled tribe. So now, the question comes, why do British wanted to put them as forest tribes, and why it is a primitive tribe? It's because the purpose of British was to exploit the nature and the natural resources. The protest was there because it has affected the livelihood of the tribals. Therefore, they fought. And that is why they have been projected as forest tribals, because forest has to be protected, and forest has created problem to both the people. The Britishers who wanted to exploit, they could not do it smoothly. Not the tribals wanted to have as usual livelihood processes from the natural resources. That was also affected by British intervention. That is why they have been put as forest tribes. Later on, when the visitors and some of the British agents visited those areas, they realized that there are typical type of cultural processes or institutions. So therefore, they say that which is not based on science, as they as Britishers perceive, they put it as a primitive. They are rustic, stain, lap of nature is a nude, like that. So they do not have proper sanitation. All these things are taken together, they said that they are primitive tribals because they did not use the higher technology. They were using the pre-agricultural technology. That is why they were living hand to mouth. Whatever the nature provides them, they survive. So that is created impression with the British agents to put them as primitive tribe. Then this, with the background of the tribe, forest tribe, hill tribe, backward tribals, then this primitive tribes, Government of India after independence thought that they since have been exploited by the outsiders. a historical injustice has been made to them. So they need to be restored, given some protection. And therefore, in the constitution, they have been given certain, say, supports. That is why they have been treated as preferential discriminated category. They are not numerically identified, say, they are not identified as a group. They are identified as a category, because for administration of the government of India, they have been scheduled. Now, this is how, say, who has identified, because there were people, professors like Rai Burman, who stated that they are political administrative categories. And these political administrative categories of people are known as scheduled tribes. They need to be handled differentially at different places. For example, say we have in constitution, we have got 12 schedules. Now, two schedules are very important. Schedule fifth and schedule sixth. Schedule fifth is dealing with the tribal areas of say, Middle India and Eastern India, and Northeast is under the control, I mean, were administered under sixth schedule. So the sixth schedule and fifth schedule has given rise to a huge number of avenues for protection of the tribals. Now, Rai Burman stated that although Article 342 has defined the people to be treated as scheduled tribes since they have been enlisted under Article 342 and approved by President of India, it was not convincing to many people that a tribe is defined and therefore they have been put as a scheduled tribe. Now, even today I tell you, say, well, let me tell, give some examples, like Endrabeti, the famous sociologist and adult anthropologist, who stated, it is not the question of identity which is problematic. It is the question of to define them is a problematic. To identify a community as a backward, as a primitive or whatever it is, easy. But then to define them, it is not possible, because to define any definition must have got explicit expression of a particular term. Now, this term scheduled tribe to be used must be universally acceptable to all parts of the nation. That has created a problem, because some people do not have certain features when the features were counted as the significant features for defining a tribe. Now, there was a professor in our Sambalpur University, who was later on a professor in South Gujarat University, Jagannath Pathy. He's a man of Orissa, man of Ganjam district. He stated that tribe to define has to be fulfilled three criteria. One is that it is to be treated as a stage in the evolution process. Second, that there are common institutions, including the different forms of a cooperative of labor. As earlier I was telling, that there are concept of panti, concept of customary law, those things are treated as a significant identity for putting some group as a scheduled tribe. There was another professor from Assam. He is known as, he is no more, he is known as D.N. Majumdar, who put the tribes as categories like assimilated tribes, adaptive tribes, commensalic type, that they, where they eat together, symbolic and acculturative type, which is relevant now, as he said, which is relevant then time, as he argued, but then at present it is no more relevant. Any study suggests tenets like cohesiveness, political consciousness for themselves and for the outside of that, as Santals say, inside a Diku, outside a Diku. Diku means exploiters. Those people who are exploiting their own people, and they are by birth Santal, they are known as insider Diku. The Diku means exploiter, and the outside non-Santals are who are exploiting are known as outside Diku. So this is how they, there is a consciousness among the people, and there are social differences system. It is true that tribes do not have a hierarchical order as that of the caste, but then there is a differentiation, and without hierarchy, they live in a particular area, and there is a kinship network of relations among them. It is stated that they are having simple productive forces, like the whatever bow, arrow, collection, furrow, like say spread, traditional type of hoe, those things. And these are in earlier a type of productive forces, including their labor. Now, Insurance of poverty among them is too much. Most of the people who have been identified as scheduled tribes were of low literacy and they believe on folk religion. They have distinct mythology. They believe that they have been derived from a particular type of say animate or inanimate objects, like what they call as totem. What in anthropology we call as a totem. They have a common dialect. Some, of course, have got language like Olchiki. In case of Santal, they have a language known as Olchiki. Now, Olchiki has got that position at par with other languages under, say, Schedule 8 of the Constitution. Most of the tribal people have got stringent cultural practices, and mostly they depend on nature for their subsistence. But then, look at this situation. You talk of any animal, including men, is a territorial conscious. As we say, this is my house, from this area to this area is my land. Like that, tribals had also a type of a territorial concept. And this territorial concept is normally demarcated by natural identities like river, like mountain, like long surviving plants, like the ancestral spirits abode, like abode of the deity, abode of the ancestral deity. Those things who are almost as a part of identities and demarcating points to justify a particular territory as their own. So normally, the people who are living in that area have a cohesive force among themselves. They have a shared mutual understanding, mutual cooperation, help each other to look after their bovines. Bovines means, say, domestic animals. And also, they maintain endogamy within them. They don't give their daughters outside their own tribal, say, identity, tribal group. All tribals, say, we have a number of tribals. Each tribal maintain endogamy of its own. Now, we have seen, it is also stated that when you talk of policy, it's a blueprint. It's giving a directive, a direct direction for implementation of certain things. So therefore, when the policy has been discussed, we see that some tribal people, those who are reclosed in their nomenclature, are not treated as scheduled tribes. Like Sohra is not Sohra. Sohra is a tribe, scheduled tribe. Sohra is not a tribe. Sohra is not included as scheduled. Like that, there are a number of communities. Say, Jhudia Parja is not included as a tribe. Even if we have recommended to be included under Article number 342, but then it has never been entertained by the Government of India. So this is how to say that what the executives have the power. In fact, the executives have no power to go beyond the explicit term given in the, say, article. If it is accepted, the exact nomenclature, the spelling must be the same. Therefore, and there is the corollary words, some say kond, kodam, these are the things. But then supposing there is a koenda, referred to, there is a particular group known as supposing koenda. They are not treated as a kondo. Like Kondadora is not treated as a scheduled tribe in Orissa for many years. Now it is now recognized only with regard to Koraput district, Bolangir district, and Sambalpur, Kolhapur, Koraput, Navarampur, and Sambalpur, and not beyond that, because they might have migrated from Andhra Pradesh. In Andhra, they have been treated as scheduled tribes. Now let us come down to what has happened as the policy matters, how it has come up. Now, for the first time in 1992, there was a formation of National Commission for Scheduled Castes and Scheduled Tribes. There is a ministry at the center. At the Delhi, we have seen a ministry, Ministry of Tribal Affairs. It was a part of the entire world, Scheduled Castes and Scheduled Tribes were handled by a joint committee. The committee was, the commission was referred to as National Commission for Shedule Scheduled Tribes. Now, how it has been created? Now, in the Constitution, as we know, we have fundamental rights, directive principles, isn't it? Now, we have a number of around more than 395 articles. Now, under article number 338, section 9, the commission has to be consulted. The commission has been created by the power of article 338. And under article 338, section 9, it is stated that no word, no alphabet of identifying a particular community as a scheduled tribe can be taken without the consulting to the commissioner. So the commissioner under the tribal commission, National Tribal Commission under the article 338 section 9 states that the commissioner has to be consulted for all policy matters with regard to change in the provisions in support of the scheduled caste or scheduled tribe. And in 2003, the National Commission for Scheduled Tribe has been constituted again under the same article 338. This was done by a special amendment. The amendment number 89 specifies that the National Commission for Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe, this has been divided into two. National Commission for Scheduled Caste is separate and National Commission for Scheduled Tribe is separate. Now that is how in 2003 it was mooted and it started functioning since 18th February 2004 as a separate commission, independent to look after the affairs of the tribals. We know that the fund allocation for different states or different ministries are made on the basis of democratic structure. For example, if somebody has 100 rupees, if the national, say, exchequer has 100 rupees, we have, say, for example, 16% are scheduled caste and 8% scheduled tribes. So 16 rupees will be carved out for in support of the scheduled caste and 8 rupees for the scheduled tribes. The rest amount may be for the general. This is how the demographic, on the basis of demographic principle, demographic strength, the allocation has been made. Even today, in the state also the same thing. The government of Orissa is distributing fund on the basis of the demographic principle. Say, for example, we have a number of difficulties in defining the tribes. So therefore, there was a Lakur committee. Lakur committee was formed, and it was stated that Mr. Lakur was stated to define what should be the appropriate term to qualify a group to be treated as a scheduled tribe. But then, this was, and whatever the Lakur committee has stated, it's all based on the background that what definition is given by Britishers during 1931, during 1935, like forest and backward tribes, and later on scheduled tribes. But then in 1931, as it was stated that they are treated as a primitive tribe, in 1935 as a backward tribe, and in 1956, there was the list of tribes who have been enlisted as a scheduled. And this was on the basis of the backwardness as stated by Lakur. But then this was objected by the other committees. Now, let me tell, Lakur stated a revised notion, saying that what Britishers have stated, even if we are following, we must improve this to define a particular group to be treated as a scheduled tribe. So he suggested we must see that the community must have got primitive traits, distinct culture, they must be living in a geographical isolation area, they must have a shyness while they contact with the majority people, and there must be backwardness to be the backwardness in all respects, like in education, like in economic strength, and that. And that is how these characteristics should be taken to make a community as eligible to be treated as scheduled tribes. Now, time has come to deschedule the advanced community. Therefore, it is also stated that there is an inclusion and there is also an exit, that the community's name can be removed from the list if the committee feels that on evaluation a particular committee has raised its economic standard and social standard, they may be deleted from the list. So this in 1956 and 57, Lacour indicated that communists tried to maintain backwardness has been observed in order to get the benefit. Even if they have been advanced, they are trying to project that they are backward. So therefore, it was stated that a new, say, identification is necessary. It is also known that, Lacour has stated that land acquisition has displaced people. Now, should we treat the tribals who have been displaced, whether they will be treated at par with other scheduled tribes? Because where they have been settled is not known. They have been pushed to others, and in order to have a living, they might have migrated. Or there are also possibilities that during British period, some of the tribals from Orissa have been forced to go to Assam for tea garden as laborers. So the bagan laborers, they are known as bagan laborers. Whether they will be carrying the tribal identity, whether that particular group can be identified as a scheduled tribe, it's all the problem has come up by Lacour. Therefore, the committee focused on shyness, geographical isolation, and backwardness only. But this was not satisfied. Many parliamentarians and academicians or developing personnel did not satisfy with this, because to define a particular community, these three concepts, these three parameters, as Lacour stated, is becoming inadequate. So therefore, another committee was formulated under the leadership of Kalalkar. Kalalkar is from Maharashtra. So Kalalkar Advisory Committee of 1955 suggested that a revision over the Lacour's committee is necessary. So that has a joint parliamentary committee was brought bill in 1967, and that bill is known as Chawna Committee Bill. A little during that period, we have seen that there were around 700 above, as of today we see, there are 700 above scheduled tribes in India. Now, for example, certain states like Pondicherry, Chandigarh, Delhi, Punjab do not have tribes. Now, coming down to tribal policies since British, we can see what has happened to those tribals and how British treated, and then what are the policies that has come up, let us discuss now. During British rule, in the pre-independence period, most of the tribal communities in India remained isolated from the mainstream of national life. Tribal areas were kept secluded and cut off from the rest of the people. The policy of the British government was solely directed and dominated by the colonial interest, and based on isolation and exploitation, the tribal people have been identified as people who are arrogant, who are dangerous. So this particular name has been given to them to see that others do not enter into the forest area, and the interested people, those who are interested to exploit, they circulate this message that they are arrogant, they are aggressive people, like that. But then it is seen that there are during that period there are different types of models created. Some of the British liberals wanted to give some rescue to the tribals who have been exploited. So they thought, since there are fights against the British, against the forest officials during exploitation of the natural resources, the fight continued, and the tribal people who did not have arms and ammunition died ruthlessly. So to protect them, it was suggested by some of the British agents that let us approach the tribals through a type of approach known as isolationistic approach. Now, isolating approach refers to that the people are living in excluded area. Since they are living in unclean forest area, inaccessible area, they need to be handled differently, and principle of non-interference should be upheld. That is what British told. Under the British rule again, an extension of centralized administration over the area was enforced, which previously were outside the effective control of princely state. The people deprived from aboriginal, who were deprived were mostly the aboriginals, and they have their own autonomy. They decide their own activities. They have their own political system. They have their own culture. And these are normally remained untouched by the outsiders. Outsiders refers to non-tribals who are either the caste members or the raiders, the Britishers. And during Mohammedan time, the Muslim period, there was no intervention. Though through the British administration, we have seen that certain changes are brought. It was stated that the British wanted to project their identity, that they are saviors of the people. And they say that we were never interested to interfere in the tribal right, the life of the tribal's rights. And then the manner in which the tribals are living, we did not want to disturb them. But then in fact, what happened? Because of the pressure, because of the land revenue system that they have introduced, because the resources have been auctioned, because people, non-tribal people have been given the magisterial power in that area, because the local rajas and jamindars were given magisterial power to exercise either to award punishment or reward. That is why the tribal people were pushed further and were alienated from whatever the land and forest resources that they had. So they were not treated as they were. So therefore, they were disposed of. They were pushed to the margins further. The area which had previously been virtually unadministered have been unsafe for outsiders who did not enjoy the confidence and goodwill of the people. And that is how the traders and moneylenders could now, because of the support of British power, establish good rapport and became exploitative to the tribal societies. So this is how isolation approach has given advantages to the moneylenders, to the encroachers, to the traders, and also the advocate officers. Now, advocate officers who did not understand the tribal system of land revenue, land tenure, introduced the uniform methods of revenue collection. Say they fixed an amount, that this amount has to be submitted to the crown. That is how the revenue administration has been a blow to the tribal society. Because how the tribal treat the land, the value the tribals add to the land and the forest was never honored by the non-tribal administrative officers. There were some tribes, however, rebelled against the administration, and this allowed to think that we need to handle the land issue separately. For example, in Chotnagpur and Santal Pargana, the rebellions fight against the outsiders was desperate. I mean, during early 19th century, it went to the peak. For example, in Orissa, we have seen that Orissa was under the control of three presidencies. The Nagpur presidency, which was controlling the Western Orissa parts. The Southern Orissa was under the control of the Madras presidency. And Northern Orissa was under the control of the Bengal presidency. Now, these presidencies were controlling, and they were sending their local jamindars to own and administer the area. Santals, Veels, and many people, even in Saura, in Gumsar rebellion, those things, they went on fighting against their enemies. They treated these outsiders as enemies. Santals believed, there is a story, if you go to Santal area, you can interact with the old people, they can say, it's still in the living memory of those guys. They say that there are more than 10,000 men were killed in the rebellion by the Britishers and British support people, those who are supporting the British people, they killed. And this killing was during 1855. None of these insurrections were aimed primarily at the British administration, but then there was a reaction to their exploitation and oppression by the Hindu landlords and moneylenders. In some cases, the rebellions led the officials inquire and the legislative enactment and the protecting tribals right over land was discussed. Now, let me tell you, in most of the areas, encroachment on land held by the tribals continued even till recently, it was still continuing. It was stated in our own independent India, it was stated that with the approval of the appropriate authority, the land held by the tribal can be transferred to the non-tribals. Of course, now, since recently it was banned, and no tribal land can be transferred at any cost to non-tribals. But then it's still there. A tribe can purchase the land from other tribes. There are examples of... Hello?
Yes?
Yeah. Do you have any question? Would you like to intervene? Would you like to have raised... are you raising any question?
No, sir. Please continue.
These groups were denied equal rights. The tribals were not given equal rights. And that is how it's continued to fight against the arrogance of the people continued. India, let us see how India is believing the tribals after independence. For a number of years, the same British rules continued. I shall give you a small example. We have Land Acquisition Act. The Land Acquisition Act of 1894 continued as such till 1984. And it for the first time amended during 1984. Now, still, land has been the attracting, property for almost all. You talk of the industry, you talk of politicians, you talk of rich people, you talk of money. And the tribals are becoming the losers. If you read the books written by B.D. Sharma, you can realize he was a commissioner for some time in tribal affairs. He was an IAS. He was also vice chancellor of Nehru for some time. He wrote a few books. He said, tribals were historically, exploited. There is a historical injustice made to them, and they were subjected to exploiters' land discrimination across centuries by non-tribal people. And to address this, we need to see that they are protected. But then, earlier, we had an approach as assimilation approach. Now, I will close here as what is isolation approach, because isolation approach ceased the moment we got the independence. Now, we thought of assimilating approach, thinking that at the mainstream of life of the nation, the tribals can be brought in through the developmental inputs, through the welfare activities, through educating and looking after their health frontiers. Now, let me clarify what is assimilation and what is integration, because broadly we need to discuss on isolation approach, assimilation approach and integration approach. The assimilation is a process, right, where the identity of the community is lost when he gets merged into the greater society. A small society, for example, I shall give you a small example. Integration, to explain what is integration, what is assimilation. You take a salad plate where you have lemon, beet, carrot, chili, tomato, whatever other things. And when in the plate, when you see, each one is maintaining their identity. They are looking independent. You can identify this is a chili, this is a tomato, this is a, carrot, this is a beet, like that. And like that, India is a plate where there are a number of type of communities. they are different in culture, they are different in social institutions, they look different, the racial features are different, the religion is different. Oh, it's a diversity. But then, yet we say we are a nation. Some people, some Marxist scholars say that India is not a nation, it is a nation of nationalities, right? This is because each one has maintained a sub-nationality of their own. Professor Behura, N.K. Behura, late Professor N.K. Behura has written an article, long way I read. It was a Saura sub-nationality. That was how the Saura people were projecting themselves as their own country. So this is how, let us not bother on those things. We'll come down to what is the meaning of assimilation and integration. Now, since all food items are kept, each one is maintaining their identities. Say one can see and say that this is the plate, salad plate, where every item is independent. Now imagine if this is independent and given equal identity for every item, if we give importance to Hindus, Buddhists, Muslims, Christians, Bahamians, then we say that all varieties of religious groups are there in India and each one is respected by another. Then we say it is integration. Integration refers to that we need to stay together, but we do not lose our own identity. Now imagine when the salad plate is, you take all the food materials from salad plate and boil it, what will happen? The beet will be dominant, the color will be reddish. Now that means all our items are submerged to the beet's color. Like that, when a tribal community is co-opted by the larger society, like Hindus or Christians or Muslims, when they convert themselves to Christianity or Muslim, say Mohammedans, then possibly they lose their identity. And that is how we say they have been assimilated into the greater society. Now, by assimilation, what happens? They'll lose their independent identity, right? Now, assimilation, the process will occur automatically, as people say, when they are automatically occurring and it's invited, then possibly the small groups are enclosed by a larger group. What is the larger group in Indian context? It is the Hindus. Now, the larger group, Hindus, who are numerically bigger compared to the tribal groups, the small tribal groups, when gets co-opted by the Hindu tribes, they are occupying the lowest rank, lowest status, and thereby they lost their identity. And in India, we look at the northern and northeastern frontiers, where tribal people vigorously fought. They say, we will not get into any greater society. Even some Naga people reacted. They say, some anthropologists and socialists said that we need to develop the people to bring the tribal people in mainstream of life. But then they said, what is mainstream of life? Now, mainstream of life, as you say, you may say, you are the great Hindu people may say that it is the mainstream of life, but we believe that our way of life is the mainstream of life. Why did you come to merge to our line of thinking and our way of life? They argue. They say, so that mainstream of life becomes a problematic one. And the mainstream of life is obviously the dominant ideology of the dominant group. So therefore, it was realized that some of the tribal small groups got assimilated and they lost their identity. In northeastern and northern area, some of the tribals resist assimilation and they never get inclined to get into the Hindu fold of life. The inclusion of those communities into the Hindu caste society was rejected. And then let us come down to integration approach. Integration, as I explained, what is integration? That they live together and they project as one, but their own independent identity is never diluted. Santhal will maintain the Santhal identity. They will worship Jahira, they will have Maran Guru and other deities. They practice their own customary law. If that customary law is being honored by the greater law, greater constitutional law, possibly we can say that Santals are integral part of the nation. So this is how the policy of integration is treated as a progressive policy, and then a progressive policy is normally done by acculturation process. For example, acculturation, what is the acculturation? Acculturation is a process where two independent cultural groups live together in a particular area for a longer period of time, interact constantly and continuously. What will happen if they constantly and continuously interact and live for a longer period of time across generations? What will happen? Some of the cultural traits of one is imitated by another, and vice versa. Or maybe it may be only one community is imitating from another and one doesn't. Or both might share each other's cultural traits. So there, when there is a transition of cultural traits from one to another and vice versa, we call it the acculturation. Now, this acculturation process is continuing because the greater society is almost engulfing the tribal societies. And tribal societies are constantly interacting with the non-tribal society, the Hindu society and other converted societies in India. In this context, we say that the tribal people who are having an upward mobility by imitating the non-tribal way of life, then we may say that this is leading to something else than their traditional type of isolated community. Tribals, say for example, the foundation of integration is on the basis of equality, on the basis of upward mobility, on the basis of economic viability, and they are assured of proximity with others. That means the law must be supportive in such a way that their identity is not compromised. They maintain their own identity, honor, and that's how they can grow along with others. Not that they will be losing their identity, get assimilated to the great mainstream of life. If you look at the historical processes, we have seen that there are two, the old and the new world, that old and the new cultural groups are coexisting each other. Such a consequence was partly due to greater size of the non-tribal communities and the tribals who are closer to them, living for number of years. But then two dimensions are very important to understand. One is what made the tribal people to coexist in the entire nation, even if there are community, larger community like Hindus, Muslims, Christians, still we see that there are tribal communities who are living together and they have their own identity. This is because there are two reasons. One is that it is a vast country and there was no connection earlier. Earlier there was absolutely communication wise, it was not that effective as it is now. Now, since communication was coming on the way, the traditional way of life is maintained. It was not acculturated as it was expected. So if they are close to each other, there is a possibility of exchanging their cultural traits. Now, in many cases, they have entered to the caste system at the lowest rank. For example, in case of Kerala, we have Paniyars and Chemurans. These two tribal communities have gone into the tribal caste fold, and they are given the lesser status in the caste hierarchical order. I shall give you a small example from Orissa. Professor S. N. Ratha has written a paper long back on Sauras of Koraput, where he stated that functionally the tribal communities can assume a position in the caste hierarchy, but then they are never given the structural position. For example, what is the situation that happened? For example, Gowdas were treated as a touchable caste. They were supplying water to the caste communities in a particular village. And in due course of time, the Gowdas left that village. They migrated to some other area for better living. Now, who has to supply water? It becomes a problem. Now, nearby, Saura people were there. Now, Soura people were co-opted by the caste community in the village, and they were treated as touchable, because the stigma of untouchability is not imposed on the tribal communities. So therefore, they were entertained to supply water, but then they have never given any structural position in the caste hierarchical order, as shown by Professor Satyanarayan Ratha, the former professor and founder professor of Sambalpur University Department of Anthropology. Similarly, there are Maitis of Assam. They also achieved a position. They projected themselves as descendants of Khatriyas. And they say that we are at par with Khatriyas. In fact, Khatriya is an amorphous term. There are certain areas where Khatriyas grew, and some Khatriyas, some people, the tribal origin, they also projected themselves as Rajas or Jamindars. They projected themselves as Khatriyas. Brahmins were eulogist. Brahmins were creating fictitious relationship with some Man Singh or Dhan Singh, some Rajput dynasty, and say that your ancestors are Rajputs. That's how Rajput people in India do not have matrimonial lands at the closer geographical area. They have matrimonial lands at a distance. So, you know, tribals who projected themselves as the Khatriyas, like Maitis, they projected themselves as a Khatriyas and had matrimonial lands across the nation. So this is how, for example, Rajguns. You might have seen a book written by Rajguns of Adilabad by Herbert Heimanders. And there also it is mentioned, the Rajgun princes say, look at the situation. Rajguns are projected as Khatriyas, right? But then Rajguns were never looked down upon by the caste members, although the Rajguns were sacrificing cows. And the sacrifice of cow and eating beef was never given negative identity by the neighboring Hindu caste members. This is how in India there are different communities occupying different positions. Now let us see historically. I will come down to certain statements like Muslim period, there was absolutely no intervention. During British period, the pre-independence period, we had action from centralized administration over the entire area, and therefore new established revenue law imposed on them, and outsiders got into the tribal area. Advanced people were benefited by the British administration, and the tenure introduced by the people was uniform across the entire land. Now, look at the Santal rebellion, and then we can realize that what made the people to fight. You might have seen, even today, people who migrated to the Assam for tea garden as laborers long back, when they visit in order to trace their origin to some of their traditional villages, the traditional villages refused to recognize them. Say, I was investigating some of the Kons who migrated to Sivasagar district of Assam, stayed for generations. Two members visited Fulwani to their native village, but then these Fulwani people, kin members did not recognize them because the concept of a property was coming on the way. They had a feeling that if they recognize, the property will be segmented. That is why they did not like to identify themselves. Anyway, India is not only a multilingual, multiracial, cultural, it has got a mixed of a number of cultural practices. Somewhere there was a professor known as S.N. Kalia who coined a term like tribalization. That in a sense, the non-tribals living in the tribal area are imitating the tribal deities and tribal belief systems. That is how he projected as tribalization. Now there are such a number of concepts have been given, like Khatriyaism, Kulinaism, Rajputaism. Those things we'll not discuss now, because if I go on discussing those things, it will be very difficult to complete the required component. The integration of tribals with the mainstream aiming at developing the people was targeted to have a creative adjustment. What is that creative adjustment? Government of India thought that a creative adjustment is only possible when they are given certain inputs, positive inputs. Positive inputs as fit into their own requirements. Now, let's come down to constitutional matters. Like, the constitution order of 1950 issued by the President of India in exchange of power conferred by clause 9, section I of the article 342 of the constitution of India, it was identified that we had 255 tribals distributed across 17 states during that period. Tribes have been provided with special safeguards. Let us see what are the safeguards. You might have heard that there are directive principles of state policy. From within the fundamental rights, you can see article number 35 onwards up to 51. They are the article, those are the articles which are governed by the state and they're treated as directive principles of state policy, where it is clearly written that they are not justifiable. Justifiable refers to that if the state does something, you cannot go to the court of law to stall that. So this is how. Now, let's see what are the safeguards. Broadly, safeguards can be identified as protective safeguards. Safeguards means they need to be protected from the hitherto exploitation and discrimination. Now, educational safeguards. Under Article 15, Section 4, it is clearly mentioned that all tribal people, I mean children, have to be given compulsory education and all educational inputs, all the requirements for educating them must be provided. So we have even Article 29 also speaks like that. We have created ashram school, sebashram school, say model school, say equilibrium model school, educational complexes. Those things are coming under this. By virtue of these, Article 15, Section 4 and Article 29 supports to promote the tribal people in the educational sphere. Like that, safeguards in employment is given under Article 16, Section 4, Article 320, Section 4, and Article 333. Like that, economic safeguards is under 19. I shall give you a small example now in contemporary situation. The Article 19 specifies that one can go to anywhere in India. Earlier it was protected, and the Jammu and Kashmir was detached from that. That provisions was restricted for Jammu and Kashmir. But then as of today, under Article 19, anybody can go anywhere in India to have its own living. So now labor migration has come. There are a number of returnees. We have seen that the COVID-19 has brought many laborers to their own natives, and they faced a lot of problems. Right? Some came by walk, some came by cycle, some with family, some on the way died in a railway accident, some crushed by bus. There are still, and some volunteer organizations, some states have promised to give lift, some delayed it, some have given some incentives. Some government have given the provisions of keeping them in quarantine to get rid of this disease, to stop the, say, expansion of the disease. The protection measures have been taken. But then it is a fact that they faced a huge number of problems in their life, because the employers did not, say, allow them to continue their work. It was stopped. Say, on March 24th, suddenly, Prime Minister of India declared a shutdown, and total lockdown has come into force. just from the morning 25th March. So this has created a havoc. But then government has taken a lot of measures to help the people. And now, of course, it is true that even tribal people have migrated. And tribal are also coming back to their own natives. This particular Article 19 has given the power to any individuals of India to go anywhere in any part of India to have his own earning and have safe living. One has to live with dignity. That is how it is stated. Article 21 specified that. Article 24 is there. Now, Article 17 has stated that punishment will be imposed on those who use derogatory terms for untouchables. Untouchables has been banned by the force of Article 17. Article 46, now let me come down to Article 23. Article 23 has stated that there is a ban on bonded labor. And nobody can, so for example, we have the events, we have the evidence to show that across the generations, some people are bonded. If the father has taken loan, the grandson has to pay back the loan. That is how it was continued. So this bonded and semi-bonded labor practice was banned. And this has been banned under Article 23. Like that, state has a responsibility to take the security and safety, to give the security and safety to the tribals under Article 46. Under Article 46, it's for all. Also, it is related to tribals. Now, let us come down to political safeguards. Reservation of seats of the scheduled tribes in Nagaland, in Assam, in Manipur, by virtue of the Article 371 Section A, 371 Section B, and 371 SS. This also we have seen that there are decentralization process. The panchayat level, we have, we will come down to PESA and FRA later. But then, at the three-tier political system, at the center, the state and panchayat, we have seen that there is a decentralization process of democratic identity. The democratic process continues. Now, I will discuss later on. Let us come down to developmental safeguards. Promoting the education and economic interest of the scheduled tribe, as mentioned in Article 46, is to be taken by every state and also nation. It is stated that the grants from central government to the state for the welfare activities of the scheduled tribes and raising the level of administration for the scheduled area must be mentioned, must be cleanly focused to transfer it. For example, we have an article referred to as 275 section 1. Under 275 section 1, central assistance comes to the state for the particularly vulnerable tribal groups. And in Orissa, we have got highest number of particular tribal groups, particularly vulnerable tribal groups, like Souras, Lanja Souras, Dongriyakons, Kutiyakons, there are many, and 13 varieties tribes are there, tribal groups are there, who are subset of the tribals. We have, say, 62 tribes in Orissa, and within the 62 tribes, we have seen certain groups who are marginalized of the marginalized, who are identified during fifth five-year plan as PTGs, primitive tribal groups. Later on in 2012, they have been identified as PVTGs, particularly vulnerable tribal groups. And we have got around 40% of the Orissa land area as a scheduled area. And in fact, in India, if you talk of, there are 12 states higher number of tribal concentration. Excluding the Northeast, we have got 12 states. And recently, I had taken a project covering 9 states where the states have housed the PVTGs. Now, PVTGs starting from Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Odisha, Bihar, Jharkhand, UP, Uttarakhand, Manipur, Bengal, there are a number of states who have housed some of the PVTGs. And for PVTGs development, the share from the tribal development also comes. And also there is a special provision that special central assistance, CSA, central special assistant, CSA, comes to TSP, tribal supplement area. This fund comes for the development of the tribal area. And there is also a fund that comes from the by the power of Article 275, it comes directly to the state for the development of the PVTGs. And that amount cannot be utilized for any other purpose. What has been mentioned by the ministry, that area, that particular amount has to be used for that particular purpose only. Like there is a CCD, Culture, Conservation and Development. Culture has to be conserved and also they need to develop. For that, from 11th plan period onwards, we have got a lot of money and tribals have been given incentives for that. Now, in the meantime, I have partially forgotten to say that we have Panchasil Niti, India's policy during the time of independence when Nehru was the prime minister, which is known as a Nehruvian Panchasil, that guiding the administration of the tribal area. This principle was operative since 1952. And then it was stated, during that period, Panchasil Niti, it was stated, certain vital points were indicated, that the tribals should be allowed to develop according to their own genus. They need not, tribal rights on land and forest should be respected. The tribal terms, tribal people have to be administered without affecting their own customary practices. And in case there is a necessity to develop leadership among the tribals, the outsiders people may go to help them develop tribal identity, tribal leadership, but then they are expected to remain the tribal area till tribal people have assumed the leadership. The moment they have assumed the leadership quality of their own, they must withdraw. The outsiders have gone there to develop the leadership quality among the tribals. Those non-tribals must come out. Panchasila Niti is also saying that the index of the tribal development should be on the basis of quality, not on the basis of quantity, because money cannot be taken as an item of index. If you put a lot of money for development, doesn't mean that you will be developing. The use of money must go in the line as they perceive as good or bad. Like if the people are taken confidence and the culture is respected, the priority of the people is identified. And basing on the requirement of the nation and with the empathetic attitude, if the tribal people are given chance to grow, possibly that will be the giving proper honor to Nehruvian Panchasila. Minister of Tribal Affairs is now coming with a new national policy for the tribals. Now, say a national policy recognizes that a majority of scheduled tribes are still at the lower economic level. They are below the poverty line. They are poor in literacy. I tell you, whatever the data has been given by Government of India and government of any state government, that literacy level has gone up. If you go to the field area, you can realize that up to 10th, there is no fail. Nobody is plucked. There are, people are taken to a higher standard. What is interesting is that when recently I was doing fieldwork, I have seen that students have been
remember is nice, like a type of parenting type. They can say, they can write 1 to 100. But if you ask them, what is the previous number of 16, they may not say it's 15. They will not remember. They can't tell. Like that, if you ask from A to Z, what is next to P, they cannot say. This implies that there's a parenting type of education is given to the tribal students in ashram and say Sevasram school, and more importance given to those guys when the special officers of the micro project area visits that area, the schools. We have seen that it is all stereotype. And somewhere it is stated that since they are poor in literacy, the tribal language is different from other languages. The people may be able to know things in their own dialect first, then they can go to other languages. So the mother tongue is more important. It's not other tongue. So through the mother tongue, if the teaching is to be given, it will be effective. That was, I believe. So in case of Duang, literate people, those are manipulated, they have been out, they have been given training, and they were made as the teachers. It was believed that they are communicating effective, true. But then, if the psychology, if the traditional psychology of the communities are having a lot of withdrawal symptoms, the same withdrawal symptom is being imposed on the say, tribal students. So thereby, they may not be becoming assertive. So therefore, I believe that there must be a competitive spirit among the teachers. See, local teacher and as well non-local teachers to be appointed in the school. So thereby, among them,
I think Dr. Panda has disconnected somehow. May I request Susri to please talk? Hello? I think Panda sir has got offline due to some connection.
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Madam, please take the session.
What happened?
Yes, Devidatta Sahab is saying to continue the session with your help.
Yes, I understand, but if there is any issue or what happened? Just wait a second.
Hi Jayant, I am been able to see Ramchandra Maji. Hello sir, how are you?
Hello? Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Hello? Hello? हेलो हेलो हेलो
I'm so sorry to everyone. I think there is some problem. Sir, phone receive kar lekhi debi dapa sir.
Madam, sir ka phone busy dekhuchi.
ହଁ ମୁଁ ବି କଲ୍ କରିଥିଲି ସେ ରିସିଭ୍ କରିପାରୁନାହାନ୍ତି ବୋଧେ କିଛି ପ୍ରୋବ୍ଲେମ୍ ଆସିଯାଇଛି ହଁ ବୋଧେ ଇଣ୍ଟରନେଟ୍ ଇସ୍ୟୁ ଥିବ ନା କିଛି ବଟ୍ ଠିକ୍ ଅଛି ୱି ହାଭ୍ ଅଲରେଡି କଭର୍ଡ ଆୱାର
ଟାଇମ୍ ହେଲୋ
ହେଲୋ ହେଲୋ
ହେଲୋ ସରି
ମ୍ୟାଡ଼ାମ ଶୁଣି ପାରୁଛନ୍ତି
ହଁ ସାର୍ ହଁ କୁହନ୍ତୁ
ହଁ ମୁଁ ରାମଚନ୍ଦ୍ର ମାଝି କହୁଛି ଆଉ ସାର୍ ଆକ୍ଚୁଆଲି ଯୋଉ କ୍ଲାସଟା କରୁଥିଲେ ସେଥିରେ କିଛି କ୍ୱେଶ୍ଚନ୍ ବି ଥିଲା
ହଁ ସାର୍ ଆମେ ପୁଣି ୟାକୁ ଆଉ ଥରେ ସେସନ୍କୁ କଣ୍ଟିନ୍ୟୁ କରିବା ଆଉ ଆମେ ଇନଫର୍ମ କରିବୁ ଆପଣଙ୍କ ସମସ୍ତଙ୍କୁ ଆଉ ଦେନ୍ ଆମେ କଣ୍ଟିନ୍ୟୁ କରିବୁ ଠିକ୍ ଅଛି
ଥ୍ୟାଙ୍କ ୟୁ
So I think we are in the end of the session and in this class we have learned about the historical perspective of tribals in pre and post independence era and we discussed about the Lokur committee, Kalkar committee, Panchsila niti and about the scheduling and descheduling tribe in the from the list. So we understand about the isolation, assimilation, integration, acculturation. And we also learned about the constitutional safeguards for tribal like the protective provision, educational, economics and administrative provision. And we have also learned about the governance and the paisa governance, scheduled area governance. So I think we will continue this session. In another day and we will inform you all and thank you for joining this session.
Actually madam there is a lot of things sir has the veteran and having the vast knowledge and there is some confusion actually there is the confusion with some the article 342
okay you have some confusion okay yeah. So can you write your questions to me and I will forward to sir
yeah okay. Thank you.
Donor, all your questions are with us. we can provide you the answer letter.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
All your questionnaire with us. Please write the in the chat box.
Okay.
We will communicate to you further.
Okay.
About
thanks.
Your ask.
Okay.
Okay.
Can I leave, sir?
You can write your question in the chat box.
Okay.
Sir.
Okay. Can I leave now?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
मैडम ठीक है सार के साथ कथा है जीवे
हाँ हाँ कौन है बुझे सार कर इंटरनेट इशू किच्छ थी वो
हाँ कौन प्रॉब्लम है जीवे
ठीक है जी थैंक यू सर
हाँ
थैंक यू अपन कर
तो मस्त क्वेश्चन अच्छे अटेंडेंस अच्छे अटेंडेंस तो मैं प्रॉम शेयर करूँ जी
अच्छा अपन रिकॉर्डिंग को ऑफ करके देन मते शेयर करूँ तो आउ मो पाकरे ना एक्चुअली मु भी बाय फोन कनेक्ट है इसलिए मु जेतले सार को कॉल करी तो मोर भी कनेक्शन काटी गला तो मोर चैट बॉक्स पूरा
मु भी काटी की कॉली सार बिजी देखला सार मे भी फोन ने कनेक्ट है चले तो सार सिट में प्रॉब्लम होई थी से ट्राई करती है से फोन रिसीव कर ना कर
हां ना ना मोर चैट बॉक्स पूरा क्लियर हे गला तो मो पाखरे किसी मैसेज रहिला नी
की ना ना चैट बॉक्स आसी हो चैट बॉक्स आसी हो गूगल आसी हो बस तने
ठीक
है सेटा अटेंडेंस दीटा हम शेयर कर दो छ
अच्छा ठीक है हां थैंक यू बाय